Oh, Donald Trump. What is happening? He's facing a new round of resistance from within his own party. Will the latest movement succeed where past efforts have failed? Let's ask my party panel tonight. It's Abby Huntsman. She is a Fox News reporter and also the daughter of a former Utah governor. That's okay. Michael Malis is here, also the daughter of a former Utah governor and Observer columnist. Chris Barron is back, LGBT for Trump. He's the founder, but no Q.
No. I told you, I'm not questioning.
I'm pretty
sold on this. There's not a lot of things in life that I'm really sold on, but this is one I'm like, I've committed to.
All right, well done.
I'm not questioning.
Finally, someone takes a bold approach. So, Abby, I will start with you. These 50 former aides and cabinet members, will they have any impact on the election?
I don't think immediately, because if you think about who's on this list, first of all, interestingly, no one that has been a former Secretary of State is on this list. You know they were asked to sign it. Obviously, they said no.
A lot of Condoleezza Rice's aides, though.
A lot of aides. A lot of former George W. Bush folks. But these are all insiders, and these are the this is the reason Donald Trump is running, right? To say, I am not these people. I'm actually the opposite. I am an outsider here. So he's saying, this is actually a compliment to me. The question is, he's going to need some of these folks if he wins, because you're going to need the smartest people around you on foreign policy. Are they going to be able to change their mind and say, you know what, he won, maybe we should get on the bandwagon?
He says they're not the smartest. He says, Wiener Neener, you guys have created all the problems in the world. Don't need you, never wanted you.
By the way, these same people would be writing this letter if Rand Paul was the nominee. What this is about is that they're super unhappy that Donald Trump's not paying fealty to their neocon approach, which, by the way, he's right. It hasn't worked. The globe's not a safer place because of these people. Like, I don't think that this hurts Donald Trump at all. And I hope when Trump is elected that he doesn't give these people a job, because if he's going to surround himself with the best and brightest, these folks are not it.
But Hillary is sitting up applauding like a seal.
Yeah, but because look, if Romney...
How does a seal applaud?
Yeah, exactly right, Abby. Very good.
I have to be the serious one all of a sudden.
Yeah.
If Romney and McCain going after Trump aren't going to hurt him, 50 nobodies that have no, you know, currency with the general public certainly are going to have a job with that. And these people's foreign policy was such a disaster. We had a wave election in 06 for the Democrats.
Yeah, people think John Negroponte is a microaggression. They don't realize.
Yeah, tell that to the people in Iraq, you know, and all the kids who are being killed by drones every single day. So if it wasn't for these people, you wouldn't have 06 and 08 for the Democrats. You wouldn't have had Obamacare and a 60-seat majority in the Senate and the House.
So you really blame them. Are you? You sound like you're on the Trump bandwagon.
I'm on the anarchy bandwagon, and I'm on the chaos bandwagon, and both these candidates are bringing it, so I'm giddy this year.
So it's no lose for you either way. Are you going to vote for one of them?
I wrote an article about why I don't vote, and I do not believe in voting morally.
What about Evan McMullen?
Please. McLovin?
The day I vote for the day I vote for the CIA is the day you find my body in my house mysteriously. Give me a break.
Being eaten by cockroaches?
Yes.
And teacup poodles?
Maybe.
I don't know. Evan McMullen, what do you make of this? I mean, it's such a desperate attempt.
It is like, this is when, like, you know, Jump the Shark doesn't even really do justice to what Never Trump has done here. Originally, it was going to be Mitt Romney.
Right.
It was going to be Ben Sasse. It was going to be Tom Coburn. It was going to be some obscure guy who wrote for a National Review. And we get trotted out the guy who no one's ever heard of, who used to be a congressional staffer. Look, are you running for president?
Single, though. I mean,
if your name doesn't appear on the ballot, are you actually running for president?
Well, I didn't know he was Mormon either, by the way. We could be related.
Well, this
for all I know.
This is how disgusting these people are. They always say the base should fall in line and go for the moderate candidate, and they never return the favor. And they could have voted for moderate Republicans, Garrett Johnson, William Weld, and they're giving the finger and they're bringing forth the fifth candidate. They're traitors, and they have no loyalty to the conservatives.
It's all about the neocons.
And Katie McFarland, who's coming up on the show in just a little bit, she said something very interesting. We still have a lot to see from WikiLeaks.
Yes.
And I think they could divulge stuff that could hurt both sides. Yeah. And like I've said before, we are two scandals away from a Gary Johnson presidency. Last month, Donald Trump protested the presidential debate schedule, pointing out that two of the three debates are on the same nights as NFL games. Darn you, fool! Last night, Hillary Clinton said that she will indeed be at the debates and challenged Trump to join her. And of course, today, Trump accepted the challenge with the caveat that he wants to see the conditions, and says he's still saying that he isn't happy with two of them coming opposite football. But it's impossible not to be opposite football. He is going to participate. It's kind of funny that Hillary threw down the gauntlet first, though.
Yeah, because she doesn't want to debate him. I mean, look, her whole primary strategy was to hold as few debates as possible and hold them on nights when nobody's watching. Yeah. And that's what she wants here. She doesn't want the entire country to see her and Donald Trump on stage together because she doesn't know what she's going to get out of Donald Trump. And quite frankly, none of us do. And I want to see
it. I don't think Donald Trump knows what's going to come out of Donald
Trump. It's going to be great television
no
matter what.
Come out of her because, you know, she's really good with the policy specifics. She's a boring librarian. She's a busybody. And she's going to needle him to death with facts, which are his accusers.
But all he has to do is, if let's say Libya comes up, he can just say in the Donald Trump fashion, well, how did that go for you?
Yeah.
That's all he has to say. And at this point, you've seen the poll numbers in the past week. I mean, he's got nothing to lose by doing this.
And no one's ever talked back to her. No one's ever talked back.
And he can do it. They know each other personally. We forget they've been invited to each other's wedding.
He knows what's going to come out of her mouth, and that's clearing her throat and coughing. She's not quick on her feet, and she's not steady on her feet, as we've seen this last week. There was that photo of her being held up the stairs.
That was a six-month-old picture after she
fell. Oh, now she's better? The point is, and I'm serious.
That was
that moment. Oh, boo-hoo. Huh. This is why the Republicans lose, because they don't want to be mean to a woman who's happy killing people overseas because they cross her. Are you kidding me? Oh, let's not be mean. The Republicans are going to be the not mean party? Since when?
When she trips on the stairs, say she's got mental problems?
No, she's had a stroke. And she had a blood clot in her brain by her own admission.
I'm just saying this race has become so personal. I think there are a lot of voters that are over the personal. They want to hear policy. And yesterday
was
kind of refreshing.
That's a lie. Trump's the nominee because they care about personalities.
Well, he can divulge his tax returns and she can divulge all of her medical records.
Exactly.
Isn't that fair?
No, we can just watch her and figure out whether or not we think she's fit to be commander.
I am a neurological hobbyist. So I can tell quite a few things just from her gait. The party panel returns in moments. Hillary Clinton is ripping Donald Trump's economic plan, but do her ideas work any better? And a little later, the parents of two Benghazi victims say Clinton's reckless handling of her private server directly led to the deaths of their sons, and they are looking for answers in court. Stay here. Hello, Pumpkin. Welcome back. It's a big show. Hillary Clinton blasted Donald Trump's rollout of his economic plan yesterday, saying his proposals are recycled, failed Republican policies that will give big tax cuts to large corporations and rich people. Hillary is scheduled to give an economic speech of her own on Thursday, monkey see, monkey do, where she's going to tout job creation. The problem is that her efforts in that department fell flat in New York when she was senator there. My party panel is back. It's Abby Huntsman, Michael Malice, and Chris Barron. Look at that pose. The trifecta pose. All right, so 200,000 jobs. That's what she promised for upstate New York when she ran for Senate in 2000. Yet by the end of her term, there was a 24% dip in manufacturing jobs alone.
Yeah, and those jobs aren't coming back. It's certainly not under her policies and her, like, NAFTA policies. And what's very curious is this woman has written two autobiographies, and the first one ends with her career as first lady. The second one's about Secretary of State. And her Senate career is just falling down the memory hole, and she never really talks about it. There's all this air of accomplishments, but when you ask her what they are, it's like, well, that's in the past and we don't want to talk about it. So it's all this reputational stuff, but she can't point to a single thing she's done besides screw up healthcare so badly that the Republicans took over Congress in 94.
No, that's a really good point. She does gloss over her Senate campaign. Yeah. When people say that she's the most qualified person to ever run for the presidency, it's like, qualified how?
Yeah.
What has she done? That's something that no one has a satisfactory answer to, and there are plenty of other people who've run and won or not run at all who are more qualified than her.
Well, that's one of the benefits that Donald Trump has, is that he has not been a politician. He has not served before. So he doesn't have anything to really speak of. He can say, you know, you got to trust what I'm saying here. Problem with Hillary Clinton is no matter what she says, it keeps going back to either Benghazi or this email controversy. She wants to get away from it so badly. But even you're reading, coming up on the show, we're back talking about Benghazi again. So she can roll out this economy message, and that's not what people are talking about.
No, it's also interesting because she keeps trying to tie Donald Trump to Russia when her relationships with Russia are so curious, and it's a very, very strange way of deflecting. It wasn't good news for Hillary last night either. The father of the Orlando nightclub killer, Omar Mateen, that filthy terrorist. The dad was spotted in the audience right behind Hillary Clinton at her rally in Orlando Monday night. Sadiq Mateen claims that he was invited, but a Clinton campaign official said they were not aware that he was in the crowd. What kind of oversight is this? I mean, that is just utterly bizarre. We know that this guy is a total attention freak. He's got a screw loose. He's a weirdo. Who knows what he knew about his son's involvement in the shooting before he killed all those people in Orlando?
I'm going to try not to have an aneurysm on TV while I talk about this because it infuriates me so much, the double standard that the mainstream press has used in this. They attacked Trump for an entire week over not strongly disavowing David Duke's endorsement enough.
Yeah.
His father was there, standing behind her on stage. He's an admitted Taliban supporter.
And you don't get those spots by accident.
No, no.
I mean, you are within striking distance of a former Secretary of State, a presidential candidate.
I think he even put his hat on at one point when she started talking about the Orlando shooting, probably afraid that he was going to be recognized. Kudos to whoever found him in that crowd.
Well, and he is like, people were like, oh, well, it's just his son. No, this guy is an out-and-out Taliban supporter.
Yeah.
He hates gay people.
Hates gay people.
And by the way, Hillary Clinton's campaign this morning did not disavow his support.
Yeah.
They came out and said, well, we didn't know he was there.
She's busy.
And by the way, CNN should have
tens
of millions of dollars from countries that kill gay people.
That kill gay people, actively kill gay people. Last word, Michael Mallett.
The Democrats have been using guilt by association since the 1930s when FDR attacked the Liberty League for being funded by millionaires. And finally, it's time for the Republicans not to be nice and use the same tactic against them. And now it's working.
All right. Well, we'll see if it's working. We'll see if it gets any traction in those polls as chaos abounds, just as you wish, Michael Mallett. I think you've got a voodoo doll on this election, and it's working beautifully. All right, the party panel returns a little later. There's no shortage of people who question Donald Trump's sanity, but one former congressman says calling him crazy is an insult to people with real mental health issues. Good Lord. But first, the parents of two Benghazi victims suing Hillary Clinton for their wrongful deaths. KT McFarland is here to weigh in. Stay with me. Horses is good. You should get it.
Yay!
Welcome back. Donald Trump's candidacy has inspired quite a bit of name-calling this election season, much of it coming from the Donald himself. But former Rhode Island Democratic Congressman Patrick Kennedy, son of the late Ted Kennedy, takes issue with the word crazy. He says that such a label is very harmful to those with real psychological issues. In an op-ed for the Washington Post, Kennedy writes, "We ought to stop casually throwing around the term like crazy in this campaign. With all the damaging rhetoric floating around, it's no wonder that people remain silent and the suffering continues." Kennedy himself has dealt with mental illness and addiction in the past. I believe that he popped a bunch of Ambien and tried to fly a plane or something like that. The party panel is back. It's Abby Huntsman, Michael Mallett, and Chris Barron. This is very odd coming from a Democrat, that he is trying to shield Donald Trump somehow from the C word.
Look, what I think has been amazing about this cycle is that we have all these words that we're not allowed to use to describe people, unless you're talking about Donald Trump or Trump supporters, and then you can call them anything under the sun, literally.
But he says not
anything
crazy.
Is fair game. I was actually surprised that he said that. Obviously, he was desperate for attention, so he thought, what's more like counterculture than
defending
Donald Trump?
He just doesn't want to be tied to the Hillary server story anymore, because his name kept popping up. Is there any effect on the mentally ill when people constantly call Donald Trump crazy?
I was just thinking about this. When we use that term, I don't think we're thinking about mentally ill. I think we're just oftentimes talking about people that we just disagree with or think that they aren't necessarily, you know, as smart or whatever.
No, I think people truly think that he's unhinged and he's got mental problems.
Yeah.
I think when people say Donald Trump is crazy, they're not saying like, you know, like Bill Bellamy used to say, girl, you crazy.
Well, Donald Trump said
that
thing
I was kind of fun and liked to party and I was a great dancer. But he wasn't saying that I was mentally unstable, Michael Mallett.
Yeah, I mean, frankly, I'm in favor of the more name-calling in politics, the better. I mean, I call Hillary Clinton America's mother-in-law, and she's got a screw loose. I mean, when do you hallucinate being under sniper fire as first lady? So they're all loons as far as I'm concerned.
The Brian Williams School of Journalism.
Yes.
Welcome to you.
Yeah, so, and I mean, listen, this is what upsets you. Your dad drove drunk a woman off a bridge and then left her to suffocate in the car, and crazy's the problem? Come on, give me a break. This is not someone should be preaching to me.
Oh, hallelujah. All right, well, it is the Cold War. War Olympic style. I love it. Last night, American swimmer Lily King defeated Russian Yulia Yavimova to capture gold in the 100-meter breaststroke. Look at that celebration. Yulia was initially banned from Rio in that big Russian drugging scandal, but was reinstated just before the games. Oh, it hurts, don't it? King has been vocal about her distaste for her rival's doping habits. And in another display of American greatness, Look at this. Perfection. Steele Johnson and David Boudia taking home Olympic silver in synchronized diving. They were handily defeated by China. But can anyone on the Chinese team top a name like Steele Johnson? It is so much fun to hate the Russians, isn't it?
It really is so easy, too. So easy. Those bodies, though, can we just talk about that for a second?
This is what we eat and grow stronger from, your hatred. So bring it to us. We eat it like creamed corn. Yes, and it keeps us looking young and fashionable.
Is that why you have to dope?
It's a choice, and as a libertarian, you accept my right to put whatever I want into my body.
That's fine. Speaking of Steele Johnson, what a name. What a performance last night.
Is there anything gayer than synchronized diving? I mean, honestly,
yes, it is like... The name Steele Johnson.
But that may be the only thing gayer about it, is it the guy who is doing...
Now, we have to qualify this. You are a gay man. And
I am. So, so I could say that.
That's absolutely right.
But even if I wasn't, it's still the super gayest thing I've ever seen.
I love it so much. I paused the TV box last night, and I said to myself, is his name really Steele Johnson? Well done. And it was a masterful
display. Perfection,
I mean, doesn't it stir up this pride in country? You're an American citizen.
I hate the Olympics because I'm not interested in amateurs in any context. So I don't watch it. I want the good TV to come back. Yeah, I really am not interested.
Actually, you like your divers to be pros. And you like your heroes who weren't captured. Abby?
It makes me want to be really good at something. You know, I watch this and I'm like, I'm so inspired. I wish I could do that. Synchronized diving, even, I mean, that was perfection. Yeah. That really was. That cannot be easy. You want to try it?
No, I don't.
Then you're not really gay.
I know. This will be like reason number 1,000. I'm losing my gay card. Look, I'm just gay for pay. This is all just a big show.
Well, all right. Thank you so much, you guys. Chris, Michael, and Abby. Great to have you all.
Thanks.
Indeed.